What if the power grid can't keep up? The world is rapidly shifting toward electrification, and that means we're gonna need a strong power grid. But if you thought bulletproofing our grid was as simple as adding more power plants and some wires, think again. Today, we're diving into one of the most mind-blowing, colossal, and downright impressive feats of engineering in all of human history. Let's figure out the power grid together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is sponsored by Trainwell. The power grid is essentially a giant continent-spanning machine made up of five main components: power generators, transmission systems, distribution systems, loads like your TV or fridge, and control systems that keep everything in check. Now, I know what you're thinking. Big deal. We generate electricity, run it down some wires, and voila, light bulbs turn on. But it's actually a lot more complicated than that. Take power generation, for example. Most of our electricity comes from massive power plants. Think coal, natural gas, nuclear, and hydroelectric, generating the alternating current, or AC, that powers most of our world. And that's where things start to get interesting. You see, there are actually two types of current. Direct current, or DC, where the voltage doesn't change and the current and power only flow one way. Alternating current is where a voltage swings up and down in a sine wave, making the electricity flow back and forth. So weird as it sounds, even though the current is going back and forth, the power is always going in one direction, as long as the two sine waves overlap or are in sync. Now, most power plants, except for solar panels, use different sources of energy like heat from combustion or nuclear reactions or gravity to spin an alternating current generator. These generators are like giant spinning magnets surrounded by coils of wire. As the magnet spins, it creates a changing magnetic field, which, thanks to the magic of electromagnetic induction, generates electricity in the coils. But here's the kicker. Most of these generators are designed to produce three separate phases of alternating current. Why? Because with only one phase, you'd get this dip in power that goes to zero. But with three phases, each phase is offset by 120 degrees with respect to the other two, so they overlap. So you always have power flowing, even when one phase is at zero voltage. This is what the power coming out of the power plant looks like. If you ever wondered why so many large transmission towers carry three thick lines, or a multiple of three, it's because they're carrying these three phases separately. This is crucial because it ensures that we have a steady supply of power. Almost all the appliances and electrical equipment we have at our houses use alternating current. The ones that don't have a small transformer like your phone's power block to transform AC to DC, but the entire grid is built on AC. This raises a big question. Why? Why do we use AC and not direct current or DC? Well, back in the early days of electricity, the days of Nikola Tesla and Thomas Edison, this was still an undecided battle. But AC ultimately won out because it was a lot cheaper and more effective to upconvert voltage in AC. It was much more difficult to do so with DC, and high voltage is really important for long distribution. DC power has its advantages, especially for long distance transmission, and it's making a comeback in a big way, but we'll get back to that. But we've just scratched the surface of how the grid works. You see, AC has a major challenge. When currents swing back and forth, they generate all sorts of electromagnetic effects depending on what you hook up to the grid. Think about all the things you connect to your outlets at home: your fridge, incandescent bulbs, the air conditioner, a hairdryer, an electric cooktop. Some of these appliances' components have the ability to temporarily store energy from the AC grid and then release it back. I won't get into more details in this video, so let me know in the comments if you want me to do a deeper dive, but the point is that these components, which are either capacitors or inductors, return part of the power they consume back to the grid, and this is called reactive power. Reactive power sounds nice, but it's not, because that power still has to flow through the same grid that it came from. It's like having a large highway full of cars going in one direction, and suddenly half the cars turn around and try to head back against the flow. If the grid can't accommodate some extra lanes for that return traffic, it would collapse. So contrary to a DC grid, which has no reactive power, we have to design AC power grids to accommodate reactive power. And speaking of energy, it's time for me to refill mine. And I'll admit, I've been horrible about working out and staying in shape. But for the past few weeks, that's all changed thanks to Trainwell, our sponsor this week. You've got to check out Trainwell. It's fitness made easy. It combines the personalization and accountability of a human expert with the go-at-your-own-pace flexibility of technology.
It just told me to slow down. It's amazing.
I had a chat with a virtual trainer, a human, who asked me questions and built a custom workout just for me. And check this out. Workouts include equipment that you already have, and with built-in brakes, you can stay on pace. Plus, with my iPhone and Apple Watch, it even tracks your sets and reps and automatically moves the workout forward. I can even see my vitals right on my wrist. The app also has videos to show you the right form and technique. And since the entire workout is built for you, it takes out all the guesswork. I've never in my life consistently had a workout routine, and now I actually look forward to it, and a push notification reminder really helps on those days when I'm feeling lazy. It's why I love Trainwell, and if fitness is on your mind, I think you will too.
42 minutes, heart rate 121, I'm done.
Check out why Trainwell is ranked highest out of the best personal trainer apps of 2023 by Forbes for yourself. Use my links and get 14 days free with your own expert personal trainer, and get started today. Huge thanks to Trainwell and you. Now back to the show. At home, the motor on your air conditioner, your fridge, or a big power tool usually run on inductive motors and generate a lot of reactive power. But it's nowhere near as much as large industries. Industries and large commercial buildings have to pay rent for using the infrastructure to handle their reactive power. Luckily for us at home as residential customers, we don't, but commercial buildings do, and here's where it gets even crazier. You see, generating electricity and handling the reactive current is one thing, but managing how the electricity is used? Now that's where the real challenge begins. It's not like you can just switch on a huge power plant that generates 1 gigawatt of electricity, because you know a town consumes usually between 800 and 900 megawatts throughout the day to leave yourself a little bit of wiggle room. That's not how it works. Every bit of electricity you use at home has to be generated precisely at the moment you use it. You can't produce it first and consume it later, like you can with water, for example. Water you can hold in storage tanks or put under pressure and pump it and release it whenever the faucet is open, but electricity doesn't work like that. Think of the power grid like a giant balancing act. On one side, you have the power plants cranking out electricity. On the other, you've got billions of devices, all demanding power at different times and different amounts. The trick? Keeping those two sides perfectly in sync 24 hours a day without a second of downtime. Honestly, sometimes I think it is a wonder that the power grid even works at all. Now, eventually we're going to have a lot of batteries in our grids to help alleviate this problem, but right now we just don't have nearly enough. So how do you keep supply and demand balanced? It all comes down to real-time adjustments. We'll get back to why this is a challenge in a minute, but first let's address the bigger problem. Most large power plants in the world are hydroelectric or nuclear. But since hydropower isn't available everywhere, most of the rest are coal, oil, or biomass-powered power plants. But these power plants are too slow to react in time to meet the change in demand. They have to work at an optimum condition, and you can't just crank them up or down when you want. And this is where things like baseload power plants come in. These big, steady workhorses of the grid, like coal or nuclear plants, run constantly to provide a reliable foundation of electricity to meet the minimum demand. Wind and solar are widely variable, so they can sometimes meet the missing demand, but other times they just can't. That's where peaker power plants like gas-powered thermal plants step in. Peaker power plants are like the sprinters of the grid. They can fire up really quickly to meet sudden changes in demand, like on a hot summer afternoon when everyone's blaring their air conditioning. Most peaker power plants run on natural gas because they can be turned on and off relatively quickly. But even with peaker plants, there's a constant balancing act to keep everything running smoothly. And then there is the transmission and distribution network, the highway that carries electricity from where it's generated to where it's needed. Imagine this, if we took all the transmission and distribution lines from every power grid in the world and laid them all in a single line, they would stretch 50 million miles. That's enough to circle the Earth 2,000 times, or go to the moon and back 105 times. And that's not even the most impressive part. These lines are the veins of a system so intricate and finely tuned that even the slightest disruption can send it spiraling into chaos. Now, this part of the grid is another marvel of engineering, but it's also where things get really tricky. You see, as electricity travels over long distances, some of it gets lost as heat, thanks to the resistance in the wires. And in the case of AC, a lot of it is lost to reactive power and something called corona discharges. Let me give you an example. Say you've got an AC transmission running 100 miles. You could lose anywhere from 5 to 10% of the power you started with, depending on the voltage and the quality of the line. But if you used a high voltage DC line instead, the losses would be less than half of that. That's why high voltage DC lines are becoming more popular, especially for really long distances or undersea cables. The Pacific DC line is a perfect example of that, transmitting power over 800 miles with much less loss than the equivalent AC line. So far, we've covered how the power grid balances the delicate dance of supply and demand, and we've taken a closer look at how we transport electricity over vast distances. But what happens when things go wrong? I'm talking about the absolute worst case scenario. 1 minute, everything's fine, and the next, boom, complete darkness. A massive blackout hits and suddenly, millions of people are without power. But here's the crazy part. It's not just about getting the lights back on. Restarting the grid, what engineers call a black start, is one of the most complex and challenging tasks out there. And that's because the grid is like a giant puzzle, and when it goes dark, you can't just flip on a couple of switches and expect everything to go back to normal. The problem? Power plants need electricity to start up. Weird, isn't it? It's because most generators don't use permanent magnets in their rotors, but induction motors that need electricity. But if the grid goes down, where do you get the power from? It's a classic chicken or the egg scenario. Without power, you can't generate power. This is where black start units come into play. These are small, often isolated power plants that can start up without external power. Think of them as the spark that lights the fire. These units get things going by generating enough power to start larger power plants, which then gradually bring the rest of the grid back online. But it's not as simple as just turning things on. The grid has to be brought back online in a very specific order to avoid causing more damage. Imagine trying to start a massive coal or nuclear power plant without the grid being stable. Too much power too soon could cause a surge that takes everything down. That's why grid operators have a carefully planned sequence, starting with smaller plants and gradually adding more and more load until the grid is fully restored. Another big challenge? Synchronizing the power plants. When you bring a plant online, its output has to match the grid's frequency exactly, down to the fraction of a hertz. If this is even slightly off, it could cause massive instability. It's like trying to join a relay race mid-stride. You've got to match the pace perfectly or you'll trip everybody up. This entire process is incredibly delicate, and it takes a lot of skill, planning, and coordination to pull off. That's why black starts are considered one of the toughest challenges in power grid management. I genuinely am blown away that the power grid actually works, and it works as well as it does. And it's also incredibly complicated to introduce renewables into the power grid like wind and solar. If you want to see a video about why that is, sound off in the comments below and we'll make that video. And don't forget to check out our website for the entire write-up, even more details than we have in our videos with calculators and so much more. And you can support us by being a member on our website, tubadavinci.com. And a huge thanks to Trainwell for sponsoring this video. Get personalized fitness plans tailored just for you by experienced trainers. Click the link in the description to get started with Trainwell today. Thank you so much for watching.